Hey DieAntDiers, today I'm going to heap praise on a very polarizing video game, a game that is either the pinnacle of Nintendo content or a plague unleashed upon our houses, depending on who you ask. I'll be talking very subjectively and only based on my own opinion, so please don't get mad at me when I say that Super Mario Sunshine is probably my favorite video game of all time, and in my own individual opinion that nobody has to agree with, the most purely fun mainline Mario experience that would only be maybe surpassed by the release of Super Mario Odyssey 15 years later. I'm going to get into all sorts of reasons why I'm bad and wrong for feeling this way, and I'm also going to criticize the game quite a bit regardless of my own love for it, but I have a lot of thoughts about this game, too many thoughts in fact, my brain hurts, so to help me organize things a bit, I'm going to break this video up into chapters. Alright, let's do this! Chapter 1, Humble Beginnings! Super Mario Sunshine released on August 26, 2002 here in North America, which doesn't sound right. Did games as big as Mario used to come out in August? Anyway, Sunshine was the first mainline Mario game released after Super Mario 64, a game that pretty much defined the entire 3D platforming genre. That game was massively important, of course, nobody can argue otherwise, but it had its flaws. Flaws I already cried more than enough about 2 weeks ago. Point is, with Sunshine, all Nintendo really had to do was build upon what they already created and improve on issues such as inconsistent level design and an already antiquated camera system. But Nintendo, those scamps, that obviously wasn't enough for them. Before they landed on the concept of Sunshine, they toyed with all sorts of ideas, including a direct sequel to Mario 64, as well as the notorious Super Mario 128, an idea that still makes no sense to me even after watching a bunch of videos about it. Seriously, how is this positioned as a sequel to a 3D platformer, or was it just a tech demo that everybody thought was 64 sequel? I don't know, it's too warm today. Whatever it really was, ideas for that prototype made their way to other great games such as Pikmin and Super Mario Galaxy, leaving us with a relatively traditional sequel instead. I'm not sure if it's fair to call Super Mario Sunshine traditional, it is easily one of the weirdest and most thematically distinct Mario games even to this day, but compared to this? Yeah, traditional. Anyway, it's no secret that Mario Sunshine was a rushed game. According to producer Shigeru Miyamoto, after developing the new engine running the game, Sunshine itself was made in about a year and a half, and most of us have accepted the logic that it was rushed out in order to help breathe life into the GameCube's increasingly disappointing sales.
Kind of reminds me of a quote from Miyamoto himself about how delayed games are eventually good, but rushed games are forever something something, I don't know, anyway!
Sunshine released to positive reception from critics and fans alike, and its reputation has bounced all over the place in the years since. But time for me to make it's all about myself. I didn't get my GameCube until 2004 or so, a few years after it launched. I was happily rocking out with my Nintendo 64 up until that point, but my very first GameCube games were Luigi's Mansion and The Legend of Zelda Collector's Edition, which, as an aside, was absolutely not a collector's edition in any way. As time went on, I would add games like Smash Melee and the original Animal Crossing to my arsenal, but I was originally a bit uninterested in Sunshine despite my love for Mario 64 at the time. It wasn't because I was growing out of 3D platformers or anything. I recall genuinely enjoying Donkey Kong 64, so my video game standards were still pretty low back then. It also wasn't because I thought it didn't look fun or anything, no. I was uninterested in Sunshine because I was a moron who thought that the game was trying to teach me about environmentalism, and as a child, I thought that was bad. Look, I was like 8 years old at the time. I was watching South Park behind my parents' back. I recently learned that I could whisper swear words if no adults were around. I was too cool for a game about cleaning up graffiti, and that's all I thought the game was. A cleaning simulator with a pro-society moral behind it. That logic led me to dismissing a very good game for quite a bit of time.
Let me repeat myself, I was a moron!
I don't remember when I ended up picking it up, but of course I eventually did, and my god, I fell in love with this game the second I popped in the disc. Wowee, Mario's on vacation, and the enemies look all different and unique. The locales look like real actual worlds, and you can even see how all the levels are connected in the distance. You can spray these funny dick people with water and they go nuts. And the controls, oh my god, the controls are so good. So fluid and responsive, and Mario can do all sorts of new tricks and flood. A water jetpack stapled onto a game that already has so many fun control options. Are you kidding me? It's so much fun, too much fun.
And then Prebubescent Anthony had a heart attack.
I love the hell out of every single aspect of this game. I failed to dump a pachinko machine 100 times in a row. I ordered Yoshi to vomit all over everybody. I sped around Delfino Plaza with a turbo nozzle. I experimented with finding the fastest way to beat the bosses. I had tons of fun doing everything except completing the actual f***ing game. I couldn't beat Mario 64 either, but to be fair, I was like 5 at the time and I didn't play it quite as consistently. With Sunshine, I had no excuse. I logged more hours into it, got more comfortable with the controls, and I was older too, but despite all of that, I never managed to get to the boat section of Corona Mountain before losing all my lives and giving up.
It's not my fault fire is scary!
The point is, I loved the game growing up, obviously. Also, silly anecdote, but I always thought it was neat how it was Luigi's Mansion's exact opposite in most ways. I know Mario's in that game, but I like like to imagine that he was secretly chilling on vacation while Luigi only thought he was trapped. It made me laugh imagining Luigi wasting his time while Mario was bouncing around on tight ropes and riding roller coasters. But while I love Mario Sunshine, I've always known that it's quite a flawed game. We'll talk more in depth about some of those flaws later, but regardless, even as I got older and kinda stopped playing video games for a while, Sunshine was one that I could still boot up from time to time anyway. It's one of the few GameCube games I didn't sell as a dumb, stupid kid, thank God, a game that I would occasionally pop in even as my Wii began gathering dust throughout high school and beyond. But much like 64, it's been quite a few years since I last played it, so when Nintendo finally announced the 3D All-Stars Collection and Sunshine showed up on screen, I'll admit, I actually got a bit emotional. Part of the reason why is because Nintendo doesn't really acknowledge this game anymore, it almost seems like they're ashamed of it. Sure, Piantas make their way around Mario Kart from time to time, same with Petey Piranha and the Cataquacks, but besides those, a lot of the things that made this game unique are just relegated to Mario history. One exception is Bowser Jr., who made his first appearance here, but he doesn't really represent this game much since he's become more of an extension of the Koopalings. But Toadstool, the various spins on normal Mushroom Kingdom baddies, and even Flood just don't really show up at all anymore.
Except for Smash, Flood is at least represented in Smash!
So to see Mario Sunshine show up today as part of a collection celebrating the character's 3D history felt like a bit of vindication in a way. In my eyes, this game deserves to be played on modern hardware, warts and all. Not only is it tons of fun, but it also represents the weird-ass GameCube era of Mario, you know, when he wasn't fully defined yet, so his games could take place in a seedy neighborhood full of mobsters or in a legitimately creepy mansion, and also he can get a tattoo. I grew up in that era and love it. It's obvious that Nintendo doesn't love it, but they're wrong and can f*** off, I don't care. And Sunshine is a small piece of that, which makes me all the happier that the game is relevant again after all these years. But none of what I just said really matters if the game is a moist sack of crap! Chapter 2! Okay, I'll talk about the actual game now! Super Mario Sunshine, as I said, is a 3D sandbox platformer in the vein of its predecessor. In this game, Italian foreigner Mario goes on vacation to the beautiful Isle Delfino and is promptly arrested and denied a fair trial for a crime he didn't commit.
Racist! They're racist!
Mario is forced against his will to clean up an island and collect shine sprites, which are apparently really valuable despite a significant number of these assholes hoarding them anyway. Thankfully, a talking water pump named Flood just happens to be there, which means that Mario isn't burdened with having to carry around a bunch of sponges. Yada yada yada, Peach thinks she's Bowser Jr.'s mom despite a... Anyway, the story kind of fizzles out from there. Hot take alert, but when it comes to Sunshine's narrative, I think it actually works quite well. They completely give up on it after unlocking Peanut Park, the voice acting is truly atrocious, and the cutscenes looked like ass back in 2002 and look even worse now, but it's a fun, stupid, fun, campy story that doesn't take itself too seriously. I don't see the harm. In my opinion, its only crime is that you can't skip the cutscenes, which they totally could have fixed in the 3D collection, but I guess they were too busy not fixing anything else to get to that. But regardless, I like the story, it's funny, and at least it tries to add context to Peach getting kidnapped, which is nice, but the fact that it's dropped halfway through renders it pretty unnecessary, and it doesn't feel like a traditional Mario story, so I can understand why some aren't too keen on it. But getting to gameplay, in a lot of ways, this just feels like Mario 64 on ecstasy. I'm just gonna say it, I think Mario controls perfectly in this game, at least after getting used to the swing of things. Sure, I missed the long jump, and sure, I really missed the backflip and crawling, but what we get instead is more than worth it in my eyes. Flood is incredible. I've heard some people say that he trivializes platforming by making movement too easy and forgiving, but while I guess I can kind of understand the sentiment, counter-argument, that's kind of the whole point, you know? This isn't Mario 64's exact level design with a water jetpack, this is a game designed completely around Flood. And just like Mario's base movement, there's a learning curve to Flood that rewards skilled players for mastering his controls, but at the same time, using him is intuitive enough to allow for more inexperienced players to complete the game as well. He makes things easier than they would be without him, yeah, but he's an extension of your movement, a fun tool in his own right, and the game is better for it. In addition, having to worry about your water level makes it a bit harder to go spraying your liquids around willy-nilly, and there are more than enough obstacles and tight sections that require skillful use of the mechanic. I don't know, I've always disagreed with the Flood deniers, especially considering that despite the safety net that hovering might provide, this is still in many ways probably the hardest of all the 3D Marios, and that's without even bringing up the wonderful floodless challenge levels that force players to make do without them. But yeah, in terms of controls as a whole, they really nailed it, but as I said, there's definitely a learning curve to this one. Mario's feeling pretty snappy here, but if you take the time to really get used to his weight and momentum, especially with moves like the spin jump and side flip, you're sure to have a great time. Moving on, Super Mario Sunshine features 7 main levels, which is 53.3% less levels than its predecessor. In addition, this game blesses us with the unbelievably cool Delfino Plaza hub world, and This hub rocks. I admit, it's not quite as magical as Peach's Castle, but I love how every single inch of this place is designed to tantalize you, to encourage you to keep playing. Like, wow, how can I get up to that giant shine sprite and clean it up? Or how do I get inside this building to grab the shine within? What's with all these doors that I can't open? And when can I unlock these two holographic flood boxes? I love this place. The music, the feeling that this is a real town square with lots of street vendors to harass, it's so great, and running all around is a perfect play area to just practice using flood in your various moves. But back to the levels, let's break them down one by one. Bianco Hills! God, I love Bianco Hills. It's so big and pretty, and the chapters are all fun while serving as solid introductory challenges. Even fighting Petey Piranha twice doesn't bother me because each battle feels visually and mechanically distinct. Overall, really solid starting area, no real complaints from this guy. Rico Harbor! I enjoy the vibe of this place. It's so different from anything else in the Mario series, so non-abstract. It also includes some good solid platforming, but this level really didn't need two mostly similar Goober Blooper fights, and the Red Coin Squid Surfing Challenge is one of the game's few mandatory bullshit levels purely for how broken it is. Gelato Beach! Surprise, surprise, I love Gelato Beach. It's fun and even introduces Cataquacks to the Mario series, thank God! Though, this area does feature another mandatory bullshit level in the form of the Sandbird garbage, but other than that, this is a real winner and the fight with the giant wiggler is a real highlight for me. Peanut Park! Peanut Park is great, with one major minor nitpick being that it's really dumb and annoying that after loading into the level, you have to walk through a second loading zone in order to get to the amusement park. Seriously, what's up with that? But in terms of things that actually matter, this one's a hoot, but I wish they did more with the amusement park concept. Like, maybe they could have removed the outer area of the park and focused more on platforming around rides and activities instead. That would have been neat. Serena Beach! I think Serena Beach might be the only area of the game that I don't really enjoy. I love the Manta Ray boss, and the hotel is a perfect island spin on the traditional Mario ghost house, but I have some bones to pick here. I am not a fan of having to run through the various rooms and vents of the hotel, which I think is tedious and frustrating. The hotel area features two mandatory bullshit levels, aka the casino section that can thankfully be glitch skipped really easily, and the King Boo fight, which is a fun concept but features too much RNG and wonky hit detection. Also, why does the hotel have a separate loading zone and then another one for the casino? Did Nintendo not hear my major minor nitpick about Peanut Park? Noki Bay! Shout out to Noki Bay for improving on Mario 64's vertical platforming. You do have to climb from the bottom of the level to the top more than once, sure, but each climb provides a new route, which completely eliminates any feeling of repetition that could have existed otherwise. I also really love this area's self-contained story, though. You solve the village's water pollution problem in Chapter 4, which leaves the next four chapters feeling relatively aimless in comparison. I really wish this game didn't give up on all of its stories halfway through. That detail aside, excellent level all around. The third Gooper Blooper fight, are you kidding me? Pianta Village. I like a lot of things about this level, and it features a few tough platforming sections that I appreciate, but I could have lived without the two different chapters focused on dragging hot chain chomps to water baths. And of course, we have to talk about the final mandatory bullshit level in the game, the Chuckster chapter.
I love the Chuckster level.
It is stupid, stressful, unfair, and so much fun, though it really shouldn't have been required to reach the final level, Jesus Christ. Overall, I like it, but this really doesn't serve as the most satisfying final level for me, unfortunately. So that's it! There's a lot of fun to be had in these levels, but unfortunately, not a lot of levels to have fun in. I don't mind there being less levels than 64, but it's a downgrade for sure. But once you collect the first 7 shines in each level, you unlock the final boss area, Corona Mountain, and... damn it. Okay, let me explain my biggest problem with this final section. Let me explain all my little problems with it first. I hate how the fire is a one-shot death sentence. I think it's difficult measuring how to land on these clouds. Clouds in a volcano is too goddamn stupid even for this stupid game. You don't actually get to fight Bowser. Instead, you have to fight the bathtub he's chilling in, which feels anticlimactic. Also, Bowser Jr. is the main villain of this game, so we should be directly fighting him and not Bowser anyway. Bowser's voice. The fact that this final boss doesn't really test any of your abilities other than being able to use the rocket nozzle 5 times in a row. But the absolute worst atrocity out of the whole thing is the unbelievable boat section of my nightmares. First of all, sorry to be trivial, but how in the world can a wooden boat survive in lava but a plumber with Mario's incredible upper body strength can't? But that's not my main issue. My main issue is the fact that you're just expected to control this awkward boat, a boat that has not been a mandatory part of the game beforehand, during the very final section, and a single mistake is enough to kill you. Are you kidding me? Sure, there is a small boat section in Noki Bay, but that's optional. They really couldn't have designed a single chapter around guiding boats before getting to the climax? Actually, there kind of are chapters focused on maneuvering like this, but in those levels, you're riding on lily pads with very different controls. The game introduces these in the very first level, and they even show up a few times after. Sure, the lily pads are terrible to control as well, but they're much more intuitive, and at least you get used to them by this late in the game. Is guiding a wilting lily pad through lava any more ridiculous than a wooden boat? Or better yet, maybe this section could have been replaced with some good old platforming like the ones in the floodless sections? Don't you think that would have been a more satisfying boss area, having Flood stolen in the final stretch and having to maneuver through some tight platforming across beds of lava to save him? But sure, wooden boat, that makes so much more sense. What am I thinking? This might very well be the worst, most disappointing, and frustrating final section out of any mainline Mario game, and there is no joy in even getting through it. It's just, oh, the game's over, I did it, good for me! Which might as well lead into Chapter 3, all the fucking bullshit. There are a lot of problems with Super Mario Sunshine. Some, I think, are significant problems, such as the atrocious Corona Mountain, but some, I think, are completely overblown and not actually problems at all, and I want to talk about a couple of those first. For example, somebody on Twitter once said that every song in the game sounds exactly the same, and apparently that's a bad thing. This, in my opinion, illustrates an interesting phenomenon about Sunshine. See, some people love it so much that they'll praise it unconditionally, and some people hate it so much that they'll absolutely shit on it for no good reason in an effort to discredit everything about it. The quote-unquote issue of all the songs sounding the same is discussed in a wonderful article by Medium that I'll link to in the description, but point is, the game's soundtrack features a thematic motif that underlines the game's sense of interconnectedness. Sure, some of the melodies might sound similar, but each song has its own vibe, its own instrumentation. Do you want to know another game that successfully pulled this off? Super Mario World, that good game that everybody loves, that also features levels plotted on a large world map. I personally think it works well in that game, and it works well here too, because it perfectly accomplishes what it's trying to do by creating musical bonds between levels. On a similar note, some people complain that the game's island theme becomes repetitive because apparently, every level looks and feels the same. This, to me, is complete bubkis, though. This is definitely a much more subjective complaint than the music one, and I can at least understand it. Yeah, there's a consistent island theme, but are you telling me that Bianco Hills looks like Noki Bay or that Noki Bay looks like Pina Park? None of these locales feel like retreads of previous ones, with their major shared element just being water? A haunted touristy hotel doesn't feel the same as a trading port despite both being part of a tropical vacation site. If anything, I think the strong theming is one of the game's greatest strengths. It lends a solid identity to this video game world, and it fully deviates from the traditional Mario grass, desert, snow tropes because it has to. I mean, there is grass, but besides that, I appreciate Isle Delfino and the obvious attention they put into defining this place, into making each area feel distinct but part of a larger puzzle at the same time. But again, that one's subjective, I'll admit. I'm not the king of opinions or anything, unfortunately. But then we get into some of the game's real issues, problems that bog down the overall experience that can't be ignored by even the biggest and dumbest of fans.
Like me!
And while I was replaying the game for this video, I noticed something funny. So many of the most egregious issues in this game are entirely optional. That doesn't excuse any of these problems, by the way, it's just funny how I've never realized it before, but some of these issues that aren't mandatory include the broken pachinko machine, the f***ing lily pad level, and the 4-hour boat ride to get there, the dumb and repetitive fruit collecting minigames in the hub world, and of course, collecting the blue coins as a whole. Focusing on that one for a second, I think the blue coins could have been really good if they functioned like purple coins in Odyssey. You know, completely optional collectibles that provide completely optional content in the form of cute costumes for Mario or whatever. Instead, they're completely optional, yeah, but each one is worth 1/10 of a shine sprite, the game's main collectible, so for completionists and speedrunners, they're a mandatory excursion. They're absolutely not worth scavenging for considering how many of them are hidden in ridiculous hiding spots or specific chapters of specific levels. They were clearly added in to pad out the game, but it's disappointing that they were so close to being fun little diversions to collect rather than one of the absolute worst elements of the final product. Anyway, back to the topic of optionality. The base game of Mario Sunshine is mostly good. Sure, a few repetitive shines here and there, and some absolutely garbage ones to boot. It's a 4-to-6-hour experience for me getting from beginning to end, and I have more than enough fun doing it. But the problem is that this base game is everybody's base game. In order to unlock Corona Mountain, you have to first collect the shine sprite on Delfino Airstrip, then collect the first 7 shines in each of the game's 7 levels. This isn't inherently a problem. I mean, just because it's not as open-ended as Mario 64's do-what-you-like structure doesn't mean it's bad, but the fact is that this game does rip away a lot of the freedom that that game provided. Even worse, with only 50 out of the game's 120 shines being mandatory, that leaves a whopping 70 shines that are completely superfluous. Sure, in a way I'm glad that I don't have to worry about the pachinko machine and lily pad level in order to beat the game. I like that, in fact. I like not having to do stupid bullshit. But then, why are they here? What's the point? And at the same time, why should I even bother scouring Delfino Plaza for shines that don't contribute to my progress whatsoever? The answer, of course, is that many of these bonus tasks are fun, especially the ones tucked away in the plaza, as well as quite a few of the extra shines in each level. But then we reach a conundrum that plagues this game in more ways than one. Chapter 4, how important is fun? This is the question that's always on my mind when playing Mario Sunshine. I have so much fun with this game on every level, literally not only on every level of the game, but in the little ways too. Running around is just fun, so is collecting a lot of the bonus shines and even some of the blue coins. The fact that this is a water-focused island, but the levels feature very little actual swimming, the silly minigame stuff like popping the balloons on the roller coaster, even riding around with Yoshi, even if it's completely unnecessary, honestly, they really managed to botch the Yoshi in this game. But Sunshine has this real sense of joy and happiness and yeah, fun. Even the way Mario kind of woohoos way all around. I mean, this game starts off with our guy finally going on vacation, his muscles sore as shit after having to lift up Bowser so many times in 64, and even as he's out here being framed for crimes, he's still so happy, smiling and shouting and bouncing around like there's no tomorrow. It's great! It's a wonderful game with an optimistic vibe that I really do love. But then the game has all these problems, and they're such big problems. Like, why on earth did they think forcing us to play each level in sequential order was a good idea? Sure, I get that some of the levels tell self-contained little stories, with highlights being both beach levels and Noki Bay. I also understand that the levels change a lot in between each chapter, which means that shines can't just be laying around like they were in 64. But was it really necessary to create such rigid completion requirements like this? And was it really necessary to take back so much of the freedom given to us in 64? Look, Super Mario 64 has a ton of problems, but its greatest strength is in its sense of freedom, its open-endedness, the fact that you can skip whatever 50 stars you want and still reach the end and get f***ed Rainbow Ride in both water levels. Sunshine takes this philosophy and tosses it in a wood chipper. You are going to play the way Nintendo wanted you to play, dammit. Enjoy dealing with this casino for 10 hours. And even if the 50 mandatory shines in the game were all absolute bangers, which they are not, this still makes for an experience that is just lacking in a major way, a great game that suffers from requiring a much more rigid experience than its own predecessor provided on inferior hardware. And then there's the repetition that kicks in, including with the base game. Having to fight Gooper Blooper and Race Ale Pontissimo 3 times each, all the red coin challenges, having to fight this polluted piranha plant 5 times, having to chase Shadow Mario 11 f***ing times! I get that this game was rushed, but there's absolutely no excuse for any of this. Sure, I might be having fun while completing these tasks, and let me be clear, I am always having fun while playing this game, but that doesn't make the tasks any less monotonous from a gameplay perspective, any less lazy on the part of the developers. Also, this has nothing to do with anything, but why doesn't Shadow Mario just take off his costume and run around as Bowser Jr. once he reveals his identity? I get that it was just a way to reuse Mario's character model, but that always really disappointed me as a kid, and it disappoints me now as well, because I have my priorities straight, dammit. Anyway, while I might still have more fun with this game than any other Mario title, that just isn't enough in the grand scheme of things. It doesn't excuse so many half-assed design choices, a story that amounts to nothing, a progression system that's a step backwards from its own predecessor, and at times a completely broken mess of an experience. To be fair, I firmly believe that a lot of the game's broken qualities and rough physics engine make it more fun. None of it breaks the game or anything, at least in my experience, but that doesn't excuse it from being this way in the first place, which leads me to my final point.
Chapter 5, a broken mess even today, and wow, I'm doing great with these segues, huh?
Let's just get this out of the way. There is no 3D Mario game that needs more TLC than Mario Sunshine, which is funny because in most ways I feel that it's aged much better than 64. It features a more competent camera, level design that better suits Mario's moveset, and it still looks quite beautiful in my opinion. Some textures are flat and character models are a bit rough, but this game has aged gracefully thanks to its bright and appealing visual design, and with a little polishing up, it could definitely rival the look of most modern releases. And yet, for all of Mario 64's problems, at least that game isn't broken? Mario Sunshine is actually broken, and again, I think that adds to the charm in some ways. I enjoy the exploits like the rocket nozzle storage and walking into all the walls and whatnot, but it's a broken game. You shouldn't be able to skip through entire challenges so easily or literally walk underwater like some sort of amphibian Jesus. It's unbelievable to me that they ever released the game in this state. And what's even more unbelievable to me is that they re-released the game in this state. Jesus, I really cannot believe they didn't bother patching any of this out, fixing the physics of the pachinko machine, the physics in general, improving hitboxes and collision detection. It has been 19 years and this Pianta still doesn't have a dick. Are you kidding me? The 3D All-Stars Collection was a lazy excuse to re-release legacy content for full price. We all know that, and this game is proof. I still love Mario Sunshine just as I still love Mario 64, but Sunshine is even more personal to me than that first title was. It was and still is one of my absolute favorite games. Nothing will ever change my mind on that, and I will never stop being bad or wrong for feeling this way. But playing this game today, I can't help but think to myself, really? Was Nintendo really okay with this? I mean, they obviously were, but
Really?
Super Mario Sunshine, in my humble opinion, is still the most pure, unadulterated fun you can get out of this collection, even if it's not the best or most technically polished out of the three. Oh, God, no. And Super Mario Sunshine, in my humble opinion, really could have been a masterpiece. The base game is strong, the movement is well defined, the levels are interesting and distinct while fully committing to a beautiful tropical theme, the music is sublime, there's real actual platforming challenge, and most shines feel rewarding to grab. But then there's just so much other garbage, so many careless decisions and baffling design choices that bog down the overall experience, and we got no improvements to any of that in the Switch version. But because I'm an inconsistent hypocrite, I love it anyway. I love this Rush piece of shit of a game, and I recommend it to anybody who can handle some jank in their 3D platformers, because it's just pure fun. But unfortunately, I just don't think that's enough. And next time on the DieAntDie Power Hour, we will talk about Super Mario Galaxy, which is very good. Bye.